Shalom, and welcome once again to a new part in our series of the people of Israel coming home. We are today going to be studying chapter 4 in the book of Joshua. Chapter 4 continues what we studied last week, chapter 3, the story of the people of Israel crossing the Jordan River. In last week's lesson, we spoke about God's presence among the people. El Chai Bekirbechem. They are crossing the river, and they are to remember, even though they're not going to see miracles on a daily basis, they are to remember when they crossed the river, they saw the ark, and they saw the priests carrying the ark, and they saw that God is a living God amongst them. And they also learned that Moses was not something totally disconnected to Joshua, but rather Joshua is a continuation of Moses, even though it's a totally different standard of leadership. Before we begin chapter 4, I want to read a few more sentences from the end of chapter 3, and then we will connect to chapter 4. Chapter 3, I'm starting from verse 12. Pasuk Yud Bet. V'ata k'chu lachem 12 ish mishivtei Yisrael, ish echad l'shavet. Joshua tells the people to prepare one person from each tribe, 12 people altogether. V'haya, k'noach raglei ha-kohanim, nosei Aron Adonai, Adon kol ha-aretz b'mehe Yarden. When the feet of the priests touch the river, mehe ha-yarden yikaritun. The river will stand. Hamayim hayordim milamala, v'yamdu neidachad. The water coming from up will stop. The water continuing will continue, and there they will have the new dry Jordan River. V'hibin tzoa amel lehem lavor teyarden, v'hakohanim nosei Aharon habrit lifneam. And the priests carrying the ark are in front of the people. V'chivon nosei Aharon ad hayarden, v'raglei hakohanim nosei Aharon nitbelu b'kti hamayim. The feet of the priests touched the water. We're talking about the beginning of the spring, the end of the winter, the month of Nisan, the beginning of the spring. The river is full. And the water stood. Kamu neid echad. Harchek meod me'adam ha'ir. Far from the city of Adam, which is like 12 kilometers north of Jericho. Asher mitzad tzortan, v'ayordim al yam ha'arava, yam ha'melech, tamu nichrat. So the water that were supposed to go all the way to the Dead Sea, stand. V'yamdu ha'kohanim. Nos'ei ha'aron brit Adonai. The priests carrying the Ark of God. Again and again we repeat. The priests carrying the Ark of God. They're standing. Be'charava, in the dry part. Betoch ha'arden, in the river. V'chol Yisrael ovrim b'charava. The entire people of Israel are standing there, waiting to cross. Already beginning chapter 4, Perek Dalet. And the people finished crossing the river. A second time, Joshua says, take 12 people, one from each tribe. And tell them, each one should take from the river, mimatzav raglei hakohanim hachen, from the feet of the priests, 12 avanim, 12 stones, ve'avartem otam imachem, take them with you, ve'inachtem otam b'malon asher talinu b'olayla, take them and put them where you're sleeping tonight. I will stop here, but let's see what we have over here. What we have, the water of the river was coming down, the water stopped. When did the water stop? When the feet of the priests touched the water, the priests carrying the ark. We do see here God's presence in the world. But I would say there are two major questions that arise reading the story here. If we recall, God said to Joshua in chapter 3, verse 7, Vayomer Adonai el Yoshua, and God said to Joshua, Hayom hazeh achil gadilcha, today I will exalt you in front of the eyes of the people, that they will know that as I was with Moses, I will be with you. Now, we would expect that God would be with Joshua as he was with Moses. What was the story with Moses? Moses took a stick, he hit the Red Sea, and the Red Sea split to two. Now, if we were saying that Joshua is like Moses, and this seems like the same thing, we see that God is doing the same miracle as he tore the Red Sea, he's stopping the Jordan River. And for those of you who may have not really realized, God says in our chapter 4, Asher hovish Adonai Elohim et mei ha-yarden, God dried the Jordan River, Kasher asa Adonai Elohim le-yam sof, as he did to the Red Sea. So it's the same as Moses. But we're actually lacking, it seems, we're lacking something very major. When Moses hits the Red Sea, everybody sees that Moses is the great leader. Here, it seems like we're missing the main part. We would expect that if God wants to exalt Joshua in the eyes of the people, he would tell Joshua to take a stick, and they would all see what a great man Joshua was. But here, it seems like we're missing the main part. Why does the river stand when the feet of the priests reach the river, and not when Joshua says the word, hits the stick, makes the magic? Another point we see also, the Red Sea as a sea splits to two. There are two walls of water. The water is like a wall on one side and on two sides. In the story of the Jordan River, it says in chapter 3, Perek Gimel, Pasuk Tet Zayin, Vayamdu ha-mayim ha-yordim milamala kamu ned echad, only one wall. It's quite obvious that the Tanakh, that the prophet is trying to show us delicately, again, the difference between Moses and Joshua. What is Joshua's leadership showing over here? Nobody throughout the entire book of Joshua ever claimed that Joshua is not an appropriate person. He was appointed by Moses. He was appointed by God. That's not the question. The question is the capability of the leadership of Joshua. Can Joshua show leadership? An interesting verse is in chapter 4, in verse 10. It says the priests, Ve'akohanim nosei ha'aron omdim betoch ha'yarden, the priests are standing inside the Jordan, ad tom kol ha'davar asher tziva Adonai Yoshua, until the thing that God commanded Joshua concludes, vayima'aru ha'am la'yavaru, and the people run and pass. Why does the Tanakh choose to emphasize that the people hurried? What is the idea of emphasizing the people hurried? Well, sometimes when we imagine the Jordan River being cut, we might seem like there was like a big Hollywood show. Everybody's standing and seeing the water and clapping their hands and go, wow, hooray! It seems like the story was a totally different story. The water is coming down. Suddenly it stops. The water down there continues. And the water is going up and up and up and up and up and up and up. Who knows? Our scholars say it was up to 12 kilometers. Imagine a person looking at this water, standing there, and he has to cross. He has to cross, you know, it's something frightening. It is something that really is not so simple to piss. You never know, you know, when the battery is going to be finished and suddenly the whole thing is going to fall on you. Joshua is here not to show, as Moses was to show, that he is a long arm of God. Moses, when he hits with the stick the river, the sea, he shows that he is a long arm of God. He is protecting, and the wall, the people cross through the sea with two walls. God is protecting you on all sides. When you're entering the land of Israel, the story is different. There's no stick. God stopped the water through the feet, through the ark. But what is showing here is not the miraculous doing of Joshua. What we are showing here is the leadership of Joshua. The capability of Joshua telling the people, go ahead, go ahead, go ahead. And the Tanakh, using that phrase, Vayimahru ha'am vayavoru, and the people hurried quickly and went by, hints to us, yes, it wasn't something simple, but all the people listened to Joshua. And this is where Joshua was exalted in the eyes of the people. Joshua showed leadership by the fact, not by doing miracles, and the water stood on one side. What does it mean the water stands on one side? It's another hint again. If when Moses does the miracle, the people walk on, protected by God on both sides, when you're entering Israel, it's a cooperation. It's a two-side story. God is with you. You're not alone. Don't worry. But there's a demand for cooperation between you and God. God tells the people that I am protecting you from one side. You have to take the leadership and have to take the initiative. You have to remember that I'm with you, but you have to take the initiative and go ahead. And this is what the end of chapter 4 says. Bayom ahu gidal Adonai et Yoshua b'nei kol Israel. On this day, the Lord exalted Joshua in the eyes of all of Israel. Not that he is a long hand of God, that he does miracles, but rather that he has leadership and he can guide the people. But still, it's as was in the time, in the days of Moses. And this is the point. Now, what are they doing? They're taking 12 stones, one from each tribe, to remember that the people of Israel went across the river together. We remember there were 2.5 tribes that already had their part of the land on the eastern side of the river. No, they're all crossing together. Those 12 stones are there to remind you once again. When you crossed the river, you crossed with God's help, and you crossed the entire nation together. Because in the land of Israel, they're all going to be living separately. Everybody's going to have his own charis. Everybody's going to have his own problems. And he's going to have to face his own obstacles. God says, remember when you crossed the river, you were 12 tribes, and God was with you, and leadership of Joshua, showing the initiative of the people, together with God, brings us back to what we said in the beginning of chapter 3. El Chai Bekirbechem. A living God is amongst you. When you take the initiative, remember that but God's with you on the one side, but not with a stick, but rather with you taking the initiative. Shalom.